to kind of have CBIC and members of industry kind of come together, listen to our, some of our recommendations, and you know, if we could really come, you know, understand each other's perspective. So two issues which I would just like to highlight. Of course, Sachin will go into greater detail. He's the co-chair of our DST committee, who so typically guides us on the entire work. But I just want to highlight, sir, that regarding the exemption to be provided from the payment of interest to all class of taxpayers for delay in filing of GST returns during this period when there is a tremendous amount of cash crunch. And if you could set up a formal mechanism for consultation. So one is, of course, if, you know, during this payment, this cash crunch, how do we, you know, this delay in filing of GST, how do we treat that? And second, of course, on a regular basis in the long run, if we could have, you know, a consultation with the GST just before the GST council meets. I think that helps us, you know, air our view in person to all of you. But with these words, I welcome you once again. I welcome all the participants who have joined us today. And Sachin, may I just request you to make your brief comments before we invite Mr. Pandey to make his, you know, special address.
Thank you. It is an honor to host this e-meeting with member GST, Mr. A.K. Pandey, and Sanjay Mangal, who is the Commissioner Policy Wing. I don't want to take much time because we have a small presentation and question answer, and that is the main focus of this e-meeting. And thank you, sir, for being considerate to the industry and responding very expeditiously for whichever issues which are raised before you from FICCI. I would now invite Mr. A.K. Pandey to address us.
Ms. Jyoti Vij, Deputy Secretary General FICCI, Mr. Sachin Menon, Chairman FICCI Task Force on GST. I'm not sure, Shri S.B. Singh, Advisor, sir, I do not know here whether you are there or not. And other members of the FICCI. Friends, we would have preferred to have met in person, but due to this unforeseen circumstances of emergence of a deadly virus, we are not able to meet each other and have any consultation in person. I'm sure all of you are also not sitting together, you are sitting from different places, which makes consultation slightly difficult. But given the whatever constraints are there, I think this is the best possible way we could communicate with each other the issues and what the government is doing to tackle those issues. As you are aware that after this COVID period had started, the government has taken tremendous steps in various areas to ensure that the this particular virus doesn't spread all over. It is contained. Also, the effort has been that it is not only jaan hai to jahan hai. We had also come to a situation where jaan bhi hai aur jahan bhi hai. And in that line, we have announced, government has announced several relief measures to various stakeholders. And particularly with reference to GST, I would like to tell, which you are already aware, that an ordinance was brought in on 31st March 2020, by which a section known as 168A was inserted in CGST, by which the government has acquired the power of giving certain concessions where compliances were due during a particular period of this, what we call force majeure, this unforeseen circumstances have come. So, between 20th March to 29th June, whatever compliances were to be made, they had been shifted to 30th June. In that scheme of things, the one of the measures was that the composition dealers, they are supposed to file their option on 1st April for the next financial year. That date has been extended up to 30th June. The another condition which we have brought out to curb the menace of fake invoicing, which is known as Rule 36(4), whereby we have restricted the credit to be taken not in excess of 10% of what is available on your 2A portal. That month-wise calculation we have dispensed with during this torrid period, and we will be dealing it cumulatively in the month of September, wherein we will see from February to September en bloc, and the formula will apply accordingly. Seeing the severity of the menace and the disruption in business and disruption in all walks of life in general, for GST SSEs who had aggregate turnover below rupees 5 crore, for them, in effect, everything regarding payment of duty, the filing of GSTR1, late fee, everything is waived, provided they pay normally by 30th June, or through notifications we have staggered the dates. So by those dates, if it is paid. And for SSEs who are having their turnover in last year in excess of 5 crore, there also interest-free period has been given 15 days from due date, and thereafter a reduced interest of 9% will be charged, provided the entire liability is discharged by 30th June. However, in those cases, the late fee and other things, they have been waived. The for composition dealers, for the quarter ending March 2020, in fact, the due date itself has been enhanced, deferred from 31st March to 7th July for filing of the CMP08, that is for making payment, and for filing of the yearly return, that is GSTR4, by 15th July 2020. And for month of May also, whatever supplies have been made, the due date for payment of duty has been slightly increased from 20th to 27th or 12th July, as the case may be, because of the staggering of these things. Clarifying all those amendments which have been made, I would like to share with you that two circulars have been issued, one on 3rd April and another on 10th April, where 13th April, where all those issues arising out of these notifications and amendments have been clarified. We have also been able to provide a facility. Earlier, what was the issue was that suppose I have a cash in my cash ledger in IGST head, and I have to make the payment in CGST head. And I mean, in different head, it was, suppose certain fund is there in the penalty head, but it's not in the tax head, and therefore I'm not able to pay the tax. So that has been done away with, and a facility has been provided that heads for the cash ledger can be changed. This facility is available on GSTN from 21st April, and the notification to this effect is in the process of being issued, maybe in a day or two. Seeing the problems faced by the SSEs, we have, during the intervening period for filing GSTR3B, we have given the facility through GSTN of electronic verification code. In nutshell, that is OTP-based facility. as against digital signature certificate, which is a difficult for which you have to go to office and get it done. So this facility has been provided. One of the most important thing which we have been able to do during the lockdown period is that to ensure that whatever refund is due to the SSEs, we must give them. And maybe a little bit, but that to ease out of the cash proposition, it may not solve all the problems, but certainly we had tried in that direction, that whatever little bit of help, helping hand we can extend, we had tried to make the ensure that officers do work from home. We have given the facility on their AIOs, their computer, you can say all in one computers, which they have taken at their home, and through virtual connections, they were able to operate as if they were operating from the office. And I will tell you, give you the figure, that from 30th March, we made this facility available to our officers. And from 30th March to 23rd April, that is in 24 days, these officers have cleared 19,713 refund applications, which involved 7,714 crore of amount. In the process, 4,416 crore has actually been sanctioned and paid. Rest might be rejected, deficiency memo issued, and dealt with in other ways. As of today, I am very happy to report you that only 5,234 applications are pending for disposal, which involve 2,200 crore. And I have been assured by my officers in the field by 30th April, it will be absolutely clean slate. So to that extent, whatever we could do for GST return, we have done almost 100%. We are trying to do almost 100%. Another facility in the intervening period which we have provided is that while filing the refund applications, the clubbing was permitted, but it was not permitted across the year. So that facility has also been given. You may be aware that in the recent times, we have announced for legacy arrears of Central Excise and Service Tax, a scheme called Sabka Vishwas Scheme, Resolution Scheme, and that scheme is also has been very successful, and almost all the applications have been dealt with. For that also, we have extended the due date up to 30th June. Few applications are pending. They will be taken care of in normal time. Besides this, friends, I would like to introduce myself as a member of Empowered Committee of Disaster Management Committee, which is dealing in supply chain and logistics management. This group has been constituted by Government of India. Some 11 groups have been constituted. We have one group I am also a member of. And as a group, we have dealt with, we have discussed, and several issues which are being faced are likely to be faced by the people of India in general, and the trade in particular, and pharmaceutical sector in a special category. So we have tried and detailed and various concessions, various facilities which could be given to let the industry start and start functioning in full strength again. And we have been able to get the orders issued from MHA. You will be happy to know that one of the major issues in the JNPT was that the we have a lot of custodians who are from private sectors. There the goods are not being stored by the JNPT Port Trust, but by the private or public sector companies. And they were charging heavy demurrage charges after 7 days. 7 days is a free period. And suppose the free period, after free period, COVID came and the lockdown came. And they were perforce, SSEs are traders, importers, were forced to keep their goods over there. And they were not charging the normal rent, but they were charging to the penal rent. We had intervened, and Ministry of Port as well as CBIC Customs Wing, we have issued yesterday. We have issued instructions that the normal rent should be charged and no inconvenience should be made to the trade in general. Our Chief Commissioner and the Chairman JNPT, they are in. They are having discussions with the custodians, and hopefully it will be sorted out very soon. And the another issue as a member of the Empowered Committee, which I took, was that the for movement of the goods, even today, the truck is one of the most important things. Every state has its own pass system. Got it issued that the driver's driving license should be treated as all India pass. And along with that, two persons who are normally known as khalasis, they should be permitted. And this order has also been issued by the MHA. Also, we had made the provision that the drivers...
Haji, sir.
Hello. Also, we made the provision that the driver should be picked up safely from their home and be taken to the where their vehicle is lying. And we are taking all out efforts from that group to ensure that not only the industries pertaining to essential goods, commodities, but all industries which are not falling in containment zone, they become fully functional. They begin, they start functioning to begin with. Gradually, the percentage should go up, and very soon they should acquire the 100% capacity. With this, I would stop with the hope and wishing you, all of you, a very good health and safety in these historic times which the entire world is passing through, and wishing that this period gets over very soon, and we come to the situation where we are used to the way we are used to living in normal situations. So hoping that normalcy returns soon. Thank you
sir. Thank you for a very elaborate briefing about what all steps government has taken, and government has really acted very fast, and we are very thankful to CBIC and the Ministry of Finance for taking necessary steps on time. There are a number of issues which have been raised by the trade and industry. So we have a small presentation on this, which we will just run in a few minutes. And then there are some questions which I have received, which I will also pose that to you for your view on this matter. Can you put that presentation, share the presentation, please? Can you put it as a full screen? So this is a presentation which we have prepared by taking the points raised by various members who are already present here. Can you go to the next slide? Yeah. So this, Mr. Pandey has already explained to you regarding the waiver of late fee and penalty. Can you unmute it, please? Yeah. So already explained to you regarding the waiver of late fee and penalty and delayed payment GST liability for filing returns GSTR1 and GSTR3B. There are those cases where which is the turnover is more than 5 crore, then the interest is leave it at 50% of the normal interest, and due dates are extended to 30th June. ITC matching is for the time being is extended till September 2020 on the condition that September 2020 return will have a true up. And exemption from VCD and the health cess on imports of ventilators, masks, etc. for personal protection, etc. is given up till 30th September. So these are some of the measures. Already Mr. Pandey has explained what are the other measures they have introduced in the last couple of weeks. Go to the next slide, please. So there are certain requests came from the industry. Now, given the uncertainty of the COVID-19 lockout situation, the due dates which are deferred till 24th June or 30th June may not be sufficient. The only problem is that the word which is used is that you can file the return till 24th June 2020. The notification or the circular is not extending the due date. As a result, as per the GST law, if the return is not filed for 2 months, your e-way bill facility will be blocked. So this is a issue which is worried, which all the people are worried about. So either we should make the extension of due date to 24th June 2020, or make sure that there is no blockage of e-way bill if 2 months returns are not filed and all of them are filed on 24th June. This is one of the concern which we have. And similarly, the due dates, when you say due dates are not extended, but you are giving a option for you to file till 24th June, the statutory reporting like CARO is seeing this or reporting this as a non-compliance. So many of those companies are worried about the non-compliance remark coming in the audit report. So therefore, the request is that instead of giving an option to file till 24th June 2020, the due date should be extended to 24th June 2020 so that this will be taken care. And again, this 9% interest for those companies which is having more than 5 crore turnover at this point in time seems to be not giving much of a relief to the trade and industry. And the request is that the exemption from payment of interest should be total. There is no classification between less than 5 crore and more than 5 crore. Government should allow the exemption till this COVID period is over, lockdown is over. Complete exemption from payment of interest. And again, relaxation, many of companies, for example, travel and tourism, hotels, airlines, visa processing, all these are in a standstill and they are completely drained of whatever liquidity they have. And those industries and even many of others also, I've just named a few. So the relaxation from payment of GST liability should be deferred till 30th September, at least by the time we'll know that how the things are moving. And again, due dates for filing the annual return and the reconciliation statement GST are 9 and 9C. 18-19 is further extended till 30th June. Now 30th June, you have 3 months return. Then you have GST R1, GST R3B. Then you have GST R9, 9C, all these are coming on 30th June. So how the industries are going to cope up with the pressure of reporting all this or filing all this is a matter of concern. And therefore the GST annual return 18-19 due date should be extended to till 30th September. And again, the Ministry of Finance was very considerate in extending the validity of e-way bill, which is expiring on 15th April till 30th April. Now, since the lockdown is continuing, we request that the validity of e-way bill issued during this period should be extended till 30th June instead of 30th April. That will give some respite to the industry. Next slide, please. Then there is some mandatory requirement under the GST law that in case if you are not making the vendor payment within 180 days, then the ITC need to be reversed. Now, as of now, everybody is on a very liquidity crunch and people are willingly agreeing for making delayed payments. So this clause should be suspended at least during this COVID period. And that would give a great relief to the trade and industry. And relaxation from requirement of reversing ITC on goods expired. Many of the goods which are stuck in the transit, the drivers park their vehicle in some petrol pump or maybe some roadside or logistics parks and went away. Some of the products are having a short shelf life. So when the expired goods, we have to reverse the ITC and that need to be addressed. We need to give an exception to this during this period with which we are facing. And relaxation of requirement of reversing ITC on free distribution of goods during lockdown and under CSR activity. So many of those corporate companies are opened their goods and services to the public and for helping the government in complying with this challenge of COVID-19. And they are distributing goods free to the hospitals or to the patients or to the people who are front-ending the fight against COVID and under CSR activity and otherwise. And their ITC should not be released to be reversed. And whatever is required for that matter, we request the government to look into it. And again, one other issue which is aggravating the liquidity position is that whenever you have a reverse tax transaction, an RCM transaction, whether it is a import of services or some of the availment of services like transportation or 7-day cab, etc., the reverse charge payments are not allowed to be paid from the credit accumulated in your books of account, but it has to be paid in cash. You need to please consider giving this leeway of paying the reverse charge using the input tax credit lying unutilized during this period is another request. And again, there are cases where there are enough input tax credit is accumulated in one state, whereas the other state you have a deficiency, and therefore you have to make cash payment, and cash is a rare commodity nowadays. And therefore, during the interim period, we should be permitted to transfer the input tax credit balance between states inter se, so that there is an excess credit lying in one state can be utilized for the liability in. Next slide. And again, there are local manufacturers who started making essential goods such as masks, sanitizers, ventilators, medical equipments, etc., based on the clarion call given by the PM. Many people are invested this manufacturing and producing this. Now, government also has given an exemption to all these equipments, all these items which is imported from outside India from basic customs duty and the other customs duty other than IGST. Now, as far as the imports are concerned, it becomes cheaper. And if this, at least when we start manufacturing locally, to encourage the local manufacturer of these items, medical equipments and ventilators, etc., we suggest that this supply made by local manufacturers to these hospitals or government organizations, etc., has to be zero rated so that they will be competitive in supplying these goods to the needy and the hospitals and government or other organization to fight COVID. And there is another issue is that now you are not allowed to go out. So main malls, etc. is closed, department stores, most of them are closed. So getting the daily supply is becoming difficult. So there are so many kirana stores, grocery traders, etc., small time guys, but they are not able to supply the goods through e-commerce platforms because they have to compulsorily register under GST for the purpose of transacting in any commerce platform. If you can relax that rule for some time, then perhaps without stepping out of the house, we can still get the supply, whatever is required from these kirana stores. And that is another request which we have. And issue of circular clarifying classification of vaccines, etc. There are various vaccines that is imported, though there is no vaccine for COVID, but related symptoms, there are vaccines imported. And those cases where the vaccines are imported, as of now, custom is classifying under any other category and charging 18% GST on that. It is becoming very dear to the costing, very dear to the patients who's, for whom it is getting imported. So we request that if you can please look into it. And second thing is that because of this COVID reaction across the world, there is a tendency or there is a trend which is evolving that people are trying to de-risk investing in China and looking for other locations to de-risk their supply chain or their contract manufacturing, and India is one of them. One of the inquiries which is coming constantly is about testing and R&D services. Unfortunately, the export of R&D and testing services is taxable in India because there is a lopsided place of supply rules which make it performance based rather than recipient based. As a result of this, all this research and development labs, which is one of the most strategic need for India, is going to Vietnam or it is going to Thailand or Philippines, etc. So we need to correct that. We have to exempt those. You have to change the place of supply rules for the purpose of export of R&D services or testing services. That has to be done. So otherwise, we'll lose an opportunity to catch up. And then both central and state revenue officials working from home, many a case it so happened that the refunds what member talked about is coming through. To process this sitting at home. And this is coming more, this explanation is coming more from the state officers who are processing refunds, whereas central is comparatively better. But this is the thing which you have to address very, very immediately. And I think the whatever refunds which are getting sanctions are the amounts which are smaller in nature. The wherever there is larger refunds are there, many a cases it is kept still pending. Total refund is estimated to be 45,000 crores, which is pending against exports from the informal sources. So out of which 7,500 is released as happy news, but we would look at expediting the balance also so that at least the liquidity situation will improve. And again, there are pending SCIS and MEIS claims. This is controlled by Ministry of Commerce, but still, since member is in various committees, we are raising this point here. This benefit is not granted for last 18 months. It is with no explanation and no objection, no reasons, it is held up. It is not, we just not being sanctioned, and exporters, service exporters are very much hard pressed and aggrieved by this attitude of Ministry of Commerce. We should convey this. Our request is that SCIS license and MEIS license has to be quickly disposed off as early as possible, and this license should be also allowed to be utilized for the purpose of GST payments, so that the liquidity can be further improved without much of a issue with the government finances. And there is one more issue came up in this last budget. There is an amendment on the definition of value of turnover of zero rated supply. There is a restriction brought in by the formula of granting the refund to exporters. It says that the export price, if it is more than 1.5 times of the local price of the same or similar product, then your refund will be limited to the extent of 1.5 times. This is by virtue of this, if you are getting 100 rupees as a refund today, if your local price or export price is more than 1.5 times of the local price, then you will have a cut in the export refund. And the biggest problem is that this provision is cannot be implemented, because if a party doesn't have any domestic sale, where is he going to bring that price and compare that? It is going to get into lot of litigations. These are some of the things which are the points which we have. I have received a few more points from various people who are participating in this. I will, with your permission, I'll take a few more minutes to even present those points which is raised by the audience. Currently, the merchant exporter is required to export the goods within 90 days from the date of invoice issued by the manufacturer or supplier to merchant exporter, so that the supplier to the merchant exporter will be in a position to claim that 0.1% GST rate, concessional rate. If the exporter to whom the manufacturer supplied these goods at the rate of 0.1% is failed to export the goods within 90 days, then the concession is taken out. They have to pay that with interest. Now, in this COVID situation, it is the ports are closed and the transportation is a big issue. Within 90 days, getting it exported is really impossible. And we request the government to give a relaxation during this COVID period, that no supplier to a merchant exporter need to reverse to pay the differential GST and interest. That is one point. Now, because of this lock-in period, we don't have much of a mobility, etc. So people are working from home. Whatever may be those ITC claim or credit note, debit note, etc. to be issued for the previous financial year, you have a deadline of 30th September following the end of the financial year. Now, this time is very insufficient in the given circumstances. So this has to be extended till March 2021, because otherwise no activity is happening cases where they have to issue a credit note, or even they can download the data and do the reconciliation, etc. So request is that this period to avail the credit for this, the last financial year, should be extended till March 2021. And there is few more questions which
Sachin, you're not audible.
Just check mic.
Hello.
Has he gone on mute?
Can we request all those who are not speaking to go on
without video, because that will at least conserve the
data. Ma'am, am I audible? Hello?
Please switch off your videos, because that will help the bandwidth.
The video is switched off, ma'am.
Yes, you're ma'am, audible. But we need Sachin. We are waiting for Sachin to get back, please.
I don't think he's
there. I think there's some technology. You should just give us 2 minutes. We're just coordinating with him.
Sachin Menon is joining us in a minute.
Yes, sure. Sure.
In the meantime, if a member desires, he can reply to some of the issues already taken up.
I can reply the questions or the issues posed by Mr. Sachin Menon. Or then I hope then there will be no question to be asked by anybody else. Otherwise, if you have any question in the meantime, you can ask those questions. I can reply. I mean, we can handle that way.
Good afternoon.
Before that, may I request everybody to please switch off their videos, please.
Ma'am, video is switched off. Can I ask my question?
Your video is switched off. I think Sachin is back. Sachin is back.
I think most of the questions are there. Once we finish that, you can ask this question.
Yes, go on, Sachin.
Yeah.
Go on.
So the other issue is that we are supposed to be issuing an invoice within 30 days, or from providing the service or goods are concerned. And that time limit need to be extended because of the current situation. Time limit for issuance of invoice should be extended till the time this COVID situation is improving. And again, the travel and tourism industry, they are in a doldrums and there is absolutely no income. There may be reverse charges and payments which are due. So and one request is that as of now, they are chargeable at 18% as the GST rate for their services. At least for the time being, till this situation is get improves, either exempt them or make a minimum concession rate of say 5% from the current 18% would give them some oxygen to survive. And then there is cases where the people actually want to pay the GST liability rather than availing the benefit of waiting till 24th June. But the problem is that they don't have the access to the full, the complete data. So they are not very sure about the return figure which they are working out, because some of the data is not accessible. And therefore, if they can deposit the money in the electronic cash register on the basis of their calculation, then that net cash liability scenario, the amendment which is made in the law, that the liability interest will be calculated only on the net tax liability. That clarification, if it is coming from the board, it would be giving a little more clarity as to how they can address this issue. As a result, what they are expecting is that even if they deposit the money in the electronic cash ledger, even if it is not appropriated against the return, and the credit which is available under the input tax credit ledger, these two should be enough to cover the liability, though return will be filed on 24th June, so that they will be saving the interest of 9%. And that facility, if we can clarify, that would be a great help to the trade and industry. Then there are the specifically automobile industry. Industries actually have seen that almost nil sales, and it is not going to pick up that fast as well, because the prediction is that people will be very conservative in terms of spending for some time. And at this point in time, they need help. At least the basic GST rate, 28%, need to be reconsidered. It should be reduced to 18% at least. And again, the other issue is that they also need to pay compensations, and compensations need to be paid in cash. If you can please allow them to pay the compensations using the input credit, which is piled up, IGST, CGST, SGST input credit, which is piled up. If that can be used for paying the compensation, says that will be a great help. And again, there is the warehousing provision, say that you can have warehousing the goods for 90 days. And if it is more than 90 days, then 15% interest per annum will be charged on the subsequent period. In case the government can look at this, considering the lockdown situation and the disruption in the supply chain, and also that transporter is not available, operators are not available. So, therefore, the waiver of interest in case of goods which are cleared beyond 90 days, but within the period of 1 year from the date of the proper officer. So, this is that warehouse to goods scenario where the government is charging the, charging the 15% interest, so that if we can waive off, that would be a great help. So, and again, warehouses where goods are already stuck because they can't remove these goods from the warehouses. Those government should, like what member suggested, I think we should waive that warehouse rent for this period in which this lockdown is continuing, whichever way it is, whether government finance them or whatever it is, that could be a great help as far as the trade and industry is concerned. These are some of those points which I received. If you have time, we can raise some other points also. But the only point what I'm saying is that in case if it is we are not in a position to ask these questions right now, please send it to us. We will accumulate all those questions or suggestions which you have and submit it to the CBIC in a couple of days. So, over to you.
Sachin, I hope I'm audible.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Okay. So, I think a plethora of questions you have posed before me. I will answer one by one wherever possible. But in the nutshell, I would suggest to you that you kindly collect the issues from your members and collate all those issues, and you are such a senior person of FICCI, you know what is doable and what is not doable. So kindly make the list of all those things which you feel are doable, so that we are not unnecessarily occupied with scrutinizing or processing those issues which are undoable. So I would be very happy to receive any communication from you. If you are able to say give it within 15 days, you can be rest assured from my side in next 15 days it will be put up to the highest quarters for consideration, and that is what we can do. You know, GST center is not the sole authority to decide with, so we can raise the flag issues to the highest level.
Sure.
If you permit, then few of the questions which I have jotted down, I can answer in brief. You see, the foremost, one of the foremost issues are the suggestions or request of the trade is that the interest business should be waived for all the SSEs across the turnover of the last year. Now, this waiver has been done up to 5 crore and it is desired that over 5 crore also it should be done. You see, government is also, government also needs money to run its business. And at the moment, the most, foremost important thing is the health of the people. The health sector really needs money. Today's newspaper, you must have seen that all the central government employees, DAs, has been frozen. Just to account for something, I think 34,000 or 37,000 crore. So we are willingly contributing. If the government demands something more, we will be willingly contributing towards the government exchequer. Unless government has the money, government cannot discharge its social responsibilities. So if you are saying that over 4 crore, 5 crore people should be charged no interest, in reality, I will not be getting any GST in April, May and June. And then the states, we are not able to give even, we are hard pressed to give the states a share. And then the entire India will not be getting any penny till next 3 months. How do you think that the government will run? So it is not something which is not doable and something which has been done with the top brain after application of top brain. I mean, these things, I don't think this is possible for the government to do or reconsider or to consider that 6 months no GST should be paid. GST is only one part of our survival. But the larger question is how humanity should survive. Now we need to contribute from our own kitty, from your kitty. Everybody has to survive for the larger cause of our own survival of the people so that we can do industry, we can get back the best time of the yesteryears and march forward. So this is number one. The doables like e-way bill, you are saying that if 2 months are not, these things I will certainly consider. This is a doable. This is not something we cannot say that we will disrupt the supply chain because somebody has not paid or somebody has below 1.5 crore. In any case, we have said that they can pay up to June. The charge of non-compliance, I understand that non-compliance hits the business under some other acts. So if you think that the entire thing should be said as non-compliance, this is a concept. I mean, we are open to consider it. As far as due dates for 9C and 9 and the jumbling of several other returns are considered for 18-19, yes, we are open to consider. I mean, there is nothing that those are short. CSR, in my opinion, CSR activities, your proposal is not without merit. It can be, can be considered. As far as RCM is concerned, I would like to be enlightened which sector is really hit by the RCM. Please do not generalize. I know the philosophy of RCM. Why the RCM has to be paid in cash and why it has to be paid by the recipient. Now it is outward supply of the supplier. Now the outward supply taxation can be discharged by that supplier's credit. Now the supplier's credit is not being used, is not available to the recipient. So therefore the recipient credit philosophically is not eligible for discharge of the RC. And that is why the provision, but then I would like to know the sector which is really badly hurt by this RCM provision.
Sir, if you look at the tourism sector and visa processing, etc., they have royalty payments and they have various other imported services which are availing.
Mr. Sachin, I have already told you that please make out a list and be specific that these are the services and these are the service providers which are badly hit by the RCM. We are open to consider.
Okay.
And but to say that the RCM will be paid by this fellow, utilizing somebody else's credit or some state's credit should be transferred to some other state. You know, we are in federal structure. I cannot ask that this state share will be given to another state. So you are such an intelligent person. You know what is doable and which can be done and for which I will not be thrashed by the all the states. So this is again credit of one state cannot be given to credit of another state.
So if a GST council consider this and all the states agree that, then that would be a boon.
I don't want to be slightly, I want to remain serious in during this business, but how cooperative federalism is, you better know than me, right? So why do you expect some unexpected things and how much it is going to solve the problem? For solving any problem, some efforts are needed. So let the efforts be not disproportionate to this, to the problem. So my suggestion is that now IGST is there. IGST you can use for CGST and SGST. Now if you say that CGST should be used for discharge of SGST, SGST for CGST, then the whole concept of the GST will change. The COVID is a virus. This virus is, I know it is very potent, but the medical science also says it is not so potent that it can change the world. So it is not potent enough in my ways, my words, that it can change the entire concept of taxation and for such a short period we should, learn so many things that after 6 months we should unlearn and then come back. So let us concentrate on doables, and which are doables I have stated several things. Automobile sector, you are fair enough that compensation sets is there. Now to say that compensation sets should be paid in through credit. Compensation is meant only to compensate the people. You see, you give somebody credit, you give some state some credit, some book credit. How he is going to purchase anything? Book entries are not going to solve anybody's problem. It is a cash which will solve the problem. So the compensation can never be in credit. And I think the warehousing problem which you are referring to, it is a customs problem. I think the imported goods are warehoused. I think to phrase your question, I think this interest business, we can certainly look into it. Because we are as a member of the disaster management committee, we are pretty sure that the warehouses which are located in the port do not charge beyond a point. So we will certainly look into it if you are giving those things. I think vaccine, one thing you referred to.
Yeah.
There are two issues. I have gone, Sanjay, can you just show me the chapters? If you want to know the chapter heading and all those things, I can go, I have seen it. Most of the vaccines are under chapter 5. The rate is 5%. And this animal blood prepared, blah, 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 it is nowhere near vaccine. Description never suggests vaccine. And then to say that if something is not animal and human blood vaccine, therefore it will fall under chapter 68 means not elsewhere specified, that is not the situation. There is a serial number 180, you have suggested serial number 174 and 61, but there is a serial number 180 of the same annexure of 5%, where 174 animal or human blood vaccines are written. In the same 180 is there, which talks about drugs or medicines, including their salts and esters and diagnostic test kits specified in list 1 appended to this schedule. Now come to the list 1. Now in list 1, I am finding the serial number 95 covers influenza vaccine. Serial number 117 covers rotavirus vaccine. And some serial number covers some, there are serial number 181, meningococcal AC combined vaccine with dilute solvent and 193 covers one vaccine, 198. So several vaccines are there. If you have any real problem of somebody classifying under 18%, you please give me the bill of entry number and I will solve it.
Thank you, sir.
Our impression is that vaccine should be attracting only 5%. The another thing which you have said that no reversal should be needed for the date expired goods. Yeah, something during the COVID period, we are open to discussion. This point you can very well raise in your revised this thing. And the relaxation of levy on supply of equipments, medical equipments to hospital or government medical facilities. If you are talking about exempting this thing unconditionally, this itself will mean that IGST will be become nil. And as a result, the import will become cheaper and it will be, then nobody is going to pick up from, made in India concept will go for a toss. So here also you give a thought to it and then come back with your letter. As far as reversal of credit in within this 180 days, if the it doesn't come from job worker and all those things is concerned. Sorry, if the payment is not made within 180 days, then the outward burden goes up is concerned. This clause was basically brought to for the benefit of SME sector, so that they get their payment within 180 days. So it will go against that concept as such. It is not a it is not a revenue exercise in itself.
And because here both parties are agreeing that there is a problem. So. But then because of this, it is eating SME also. It is not just about one sector.
Yeah, I can, as a lawyer, not as a government officer, I can give a suggestion that the ordinance says that anything where the compliance is between falling between 20th March to 29th June gets postponed to 30th. I'm giving hint. I mean, I'm not committing anything. So,
thank you, sir.
I will not say the compliance, you may say the compliance. And I think these are the basic questions.
One of the main points is that R&D facilities, now there are a lot of inquiries coming from various US and European companies to shift the R&D facility to India. But then the point is that if R&D, if it is done R&D and testing in the, done in India, that attract 18% GST.
Sachinji,
I'm asking my friend Sanjay.
I'm Sanjay Mangal. Yeah, I'm responding to your query regarding this R&D. I don't know whether you have gone through this notification issued on 30th September 2019.
Sir, that is only for pharma.
Yeah. So what other this thing you are talking about?
There are technology based thing like prototype developed for auto companies, and there are regions which are tested here. Various even cosmetics R&D happening here for the world.
Can you send a specific proposal so that we can examine it?
Sure, I'll send you that, sir.
Then we will be getting more opportunities. We will be giving more opportunities to the foreign investors to invest in India.
So mainly China's strength was that almost all the world R&D was concentrated in China, and they have copied that and they become better than what they have received.
You kindly raise this issue, I will examine.
Okay.
About restrictions on matching of credit with 2A with regard to refund, now they are saying 100% invoices should come in two ways. That would be a very hardship.
Sorry.
Hello, sir, can you hear us?
Yeah.
Okay. So mainly recently there is a circular issue which restricts the refund for the extent of invoices coming in GSTR 2A. Earlier there was a provision, invoices are not coming in 2A, we can submit self-certified invoices. Can you hear?
That provision has been relaxed till 30th of September. That matching is relaxed. August 31st, if they have, and you don't have to go by that restriction.
So one question is there.
Yeah.
So Mars 3B is to be filed by 5th of May without payment of interest by more than 5 crores turnover SSEs. The lockdown is already extended till 3rd and we don't know it will be extended further. So this is a harsh provision. In if it is opened on 3rd also, then only 2 days are there to file the return. That should be Mars 3B date should be extended without payment of tax.
Filing Mars 3B, what exactly is needed is the supplies made in March. Now we are running in April.
But if the lockdown continue till 22nd, now from 22nd it is continuing. Offices are not open.
So you are not aware of the supplies which has been made after 22nd, or you have still made supplies in 24th?
So there are 3-4 offices and the office should open to compile all the data because we cannot revise 3B. We have to go to the office, then only we can compile and file a correct 3B. We don't have a problem of payment of tax, but problem is we have to file 3B which cannot be revised. So that fifth, if lockdown opens on 4th, we get only 2 days to file the 3B without payment of interest.
This may be in particular. But all India situation, I am telling you, after having a video conference today in disaster management. As far as farm sector is concerned, all over India, more than 50% of the factories are operational with more than 50% of the personnel. Several factories have started or in the process of starting with their business. To say that you are not able to go to the site or collect the data and all those things, I mean, theek hai, but then you see the government also needs money. I'm saying that what you pay is not going to be, it is going to be used for us only to fight the terror of the COVID. It is the entire government, entire machinery of state and center for the moment is only against this COVID.
Any other questions?
Sir, if I can ask a question.
Hello. Yeah, yes. My name is Ankit Agarwal. Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Yeah, can I ask a question?
Yes, please.
Yeah, my question is, see, after Gujarat High Court's decision in January, ocean freight reverse charge GST, which the industry has been paying on a notional amount of 10% on CIF. This should, so can we claim a refund of this amount?
Any high court, whenever it gives order, the other party also has got some time to file appeal against that particular order, whether it is approved by that particular order or not. this particular order of the High Court is under consideration, under examination, and if, as you are saying, if it gets finality, then naturally the refund will be a consequential thing.
Sir, I have a question. Can I ask a question? I'm Mihir Shah from Bombay.
Yeah, please, Mihir.
So you had mentioned about that calculation change which has happened in Rule 89.3 for the zero-rated supply. Sir, can sir can throw some light on that, because that 1.5 restriction is going to be very difficult for the exporters. And the second point is, sir, a lot of MSMEs and other exporters are still under that risky list, and their refunds are yet not processed in spite of their documents and being submitted. However, the process of their verification is either pending or not completed. Sir, if something can be done on that, sir.
Yeah, yeah. So on risky exporters, IGST refund, I'm sure you are talking about, something is being done. Our customs wing are doing, and sooner we are going to find a solution as to how we will clear it. As far as your question that valuation should be limited only 1.5 times of the PMV, present market value, irrespective of the fact what we have shown in the shipping bill. The fact is that the refund, IGST refund, is what? Ultimately, in drawback regime also, you must have seen that the garments and everything, there was a rate, the capping rate. So what we are giving, refunding, is the tax paid on raw materials. And tax paid on raw materials, in our opinion, cannot exceed the 1.5 times of the, it is not for the foreign exchange which you are going to earn. Even if you say that your product, which was 100 rupees, it is being sold in the market, and you are getting some 900 rupees by exporting to Canada, I am not obliged to give the 900%, 16% GST on that. What I am obliged to give you is that what 100% has suffered the on raw material, what duty it has suffered. So the idea is the taxes will never be exported. And the government is seriously thinking to stop the route of IGST. And I think we have come out in the so we are not issued. But the discussions are going on that the we are going to make our, particularly in wake of this fake invoices, we are going to say that under bond, the export is permitted. So that should be the normal rule. You export under bond and take refund at the credit. So that is going to be a general rule. Only in exceptional circumstances, for exceptional this thing, items, which may be notified. I mean, this is the way the government thinking is. So we are not going to fight on every front. The kind of menace, you are yourself aware that if the fake invoices are allowed to run the roost, whatever benefit has provided to the trade or to the department will be lost.
I'm sorry to interrupt, sir. Only point is, the Rule 89 talks about the same refund of input credit which you are mentioning. It's not about IGST refund. Sir, it is under the LUT refund, under the bond refund for the export.
What is your name?
Sir, Mihir Shah.
Mihir Shah ji.
Yes, sir.
मुझे पता है आप क्या कहना चाह रहे हैं. दो तरह का refund होता है. एक refund होता है duty paid on finished goods. Yes, और एक refund होता है duty paid on raw materials from which the finished goods have been manufactured, which have been exported.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes, sir.
If I am refunding the duty paid on raw materials, that is ITC, I am refunding.
Yes, sir.
What else is left? You export under bond.
Sir, in that rule, calculation is restricted, sir.
Listen. I am not charging any duty on to you on export goods, and therefore I am not obliged to give any refund. As far as if your question is that when the ITC is refunded, certain refunds are not allowed. Say services refund is not allowed. Capital goods refund is not allowed. So those provisions will be made. We'll take care of that. But then we are going to stop one of the routes. I mean, we are not, as a government, we are not going to fight. And as a SSE, we do not expect you to, chase. When the custom thing is there, you go to the custom officer. When the GST thing is there, only GST should be involved. Not this kind of risky situation where your goods are there, you are exporting, there is no flying description, but still your IGST refund has been blocked because you have been found risky on certain parameters. So this situation, we do not want to recur. Therefore, we are of the view that only one channel should be opened, and the normal channel should be the export under bond.
I have a suggestion.
Hello.
And if you can clarify that this restriction would be applied only to cases where the goods are exported under rebate, which means that on payment of duty. Whereas in the non-payment of duty, if it is under bond, then this is not applicable. That could perhaps give a clarity.
Your rule 89 is only of talking about bond refund. This is not for IGST risky exporter, sir.
It is not the intention. It is in respect of ITC refund.
Yes, sir. Completely agree.
And the issue was, there are number of cases which have been detected where people are found to be inflating their export value by multiple times. For domestic clearances, for example, the value of goods declared was rupees 100. Whereas for export goods, the same type of goods, the export goods were declared at 1,000 rupees. Now for purpose of ITC refund, if 1,000 rupees is taken as value, then the ITC refund comes much more than the domestic price of the domestic clearance value of the goods, IGST refund, ITC refund. And the purpose of this refund is to reimburse the ITC on raw material which you have incurred. So for example, if comparable goods which are of 100 rupees in domestic market and their raw materials are costing, say example, 70 rupees. So the intention is to refund you ITC of 70 rupees. And now for the purpose of calculation, if 1,000 rupees is taken the value, then the ITC claim is refund claim is inflated multiple times. And the purpose of this new turnover definition is to curb that tendency. If there is any specific problem in calculation, then I think that can be separately highlighted. We can examine it.
Anybody has any other question?
Hello.
Yes.
Hello, I am Deepak Agarwal calling from Mumbai. Good afternoon all. Basically, my question is that whether we can adjust sufficient ITC available on the GSTL portal towards my RCM liability, which will save the cash flow of the company.
It's already replied by the member a little while ago.
Okay.
No, you cannot.
Yeah, my question is that whether we can use our available ITC towards my RCM liability.
So the answer I have given, you cannot. And I have also philosophized, given the philosophical answer as to why you cannot. Mr. Sachin Menonji, if you can compile all the listing queries, issues, doables, and I will be more than happy to examine any issue from such an August organization called FICCA.
Sure, sir. By next week, we will have it submitted to you.
And
we'll invite members to mail all your queries to us, and then we'll collate it, and then we'll.
My only request will be kindly forward those only which you feel are doable.
No, definitely, sir. Definitely, sir. See, this 1.5 times, we understand the intention behind that. But the point is that how to put it in practice, because there is no database to compare the price of the same goods sold in the market, because there is brand quality and all those things coming in the picture. If the same person selling in both local market as well as exporting, then it is easy. But many a cases, most of the cases, it is not so.
We have gone through the drawback regime, where drawback was capped that it cannot exceed the PMV. There also the issue of present market value was there. Some investigations were done. So it is not something which we are not used to. So don't worry on this count. It will be done.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you for your time. And both Sanjay Mangal sir and Pandey sir, you have been very generous to us and very receptive to us. I think after I started my career almost 37 years before, what is customs and CBIC then and now is completely a transformation, and we find that you are a facilitator for the industry in trade and business. And I hope that this culture will continue. And thank you so much for this time and agreeing to come and address us and answer our queries. By next week, we will have it. All queries will be collated and we'll submit that, whichever is logically, can be done.
Hello. Sir, any further queries can be made?
Sir, I have one question.
Can I ask a question?
Writing, please. Send your queries in writing, please. May I request Mr. Shashi Bhushan to kindly give a vote of... Can Mr. S.B. Singh be unmuted?
Yeah, now unmuted. Good afternoon, Mr. A.K. The Special Secretary, Government of India, and the members of GST CBIC, Mr. Sanjay Mangal, Commissioner Policy Wing GST, Mr. Sachin Menon, Mrs. Jyoti, and all the other esteemed participants. It was a great pleasure to have you all. Specifically, we are grateful to Mr. A.K. Pandey that in spite of being so busy, as he himself mentioned that he is a member in the Empowered Committee, which virtually meets almost every day for hours. And then thereafter, he has to also handle his own work in the CBIC. So it is so difficult for him to get time even for their own work, but still he could find a time to be with us here. We are really grateful to you. And it was also really pleasure to see such a frank and advices which you have given, and especially your request to the industry to be little more practical in their suggestion and keeping in the mind what is doable and not doable. And I hope our next suggestion industry will keep this thing in their mind. So thank you, Mr. A.K. Pandey. Thank you, Mr. Sanjay. My special thanks to Mr. Sachin, Mrs. Jyoti, and Ira also, because all the pain and all the hard work Ira has done, and not the least our IT cell of the FICCI. And all the participants here, thanks all. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Hopefully see you, Pandey, see you in the very near future in your office.
Sure, sir. Anytime. Most welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.